Today we're going to talk about summer reading and summer math. And similar to the past, we have some tips and ways to keep it moving this summer. But one of the things we thought worthy of doing is also addressing some questions that we often get about reading and writing in the everyday work that students do. So we framed today's presentation around these questions roughly. Math, what is the sort of quote-unquote new math? You hear that term once in a while. What is a number bond and a bar model? Why are they so important? Why do we talk about those? Why might your children be sort of using those to solve complex math problems? Reading, why does it matter what level my child is reading? My child can read all the words. Can she, he read harder books? Another way to say is this question is like, is it just right books all day, every day, all time? No, and we'll talk about that. Writing, how can I support my child with using her writing? What should my child do in the summer to continue this learning? So we're gonna talk about like the underpinnings of the work that we do and why we do what we do, and then try to connect that out of like some options for you this summer. One thing that is a threat that you've probably heard me speak about several times throughout all the content areas is that we're thinking broader than the specific content. We're thinking broader than the concepts and strategies that we're talking about today. Like, what are some big outcomes we want for our students? Often this comes through the instructional model, meaning how we present it, how kids work together. And these are some of the big ideas, right? Collaboration. Where's your voice? How do we personalize it? How do we support students to make decisions in these complex problems? So these ideas, these concepts, are a through line that happens in all of our subject areas. So this morning, Mrs. Oppel, our math specialist, is going to start talking about math, and then we're going to transition to Mrs. Carmody to talk a little bit about reading and writing. Mrs. Oppel, thank you. Do you want me to click over here?
So I get asked this question a lot from my friends, like, what is this new math you're teaching my kids? They'll send me pictures of their homework and ask me to, you know, help them figure it out. So this is the question that I thought we could kind of talk about. And my answer is always that there is no new math. The only difference is that I learned one way, only one way, the way the teacher did it, and I had to do it that way, and I didn't understand why I was doing it. And we teach them so many different ways when they're ready for it, so that they can build like on their understanding, but they also don't think exactly like the teacher. So it's this way of like, we're acknowledging that all these kids sitting in front of us think differently, and we don't have to think in lockstep the way I think. So a lot of this idea is like promoting creativity in math and not living in this, you know, lockstep, step one do this, step two do this, and that kind of world we grew up, especially in math. So what we're teaching them is like different strategies when they're ready for it. Some are very like at the most basic level and they advance to some very complicated ways. And sometimes as even when I taught fifth grade, I would say like, this strategy does not work for me. Like, I don't even want to teach this right now. And I teach it and there's like six kids in the class that love that strategy. I'm like, how do you think like that? Like, this doesn't work for me. But the one I showed them yesterday didn't work for them. And then you start seeing the value of that and appreciate that like everyone has a different perspective. So this is the new math. It's the same addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, fractions, but we present it in a variety of ways. We're gonna do some math today. I have two problems for us to try together. So if you could just try this problem out, if you're talking to the person next to you, we'll just take a quick like 2 minutes to try it.
Here. Yeah. Oh, I get one. Oh,
you got
thank
one,
you.
Or we can share one with Louise.
I'm going to move this way.
I hope you don't videotape these.
Yeah.
You know, this happens a lot, especially in math, about how kids feel about math and what they hear at home about math. I'm not a math person, things like that. And I felt like that as a kid, and the most reason why I felt like that is because I didn't understand the exact way the teacher was doing it. And there was no other option for me. I will show you in a moment some of the ways the kids solve this problem and how we open it up and they can really solve it.
She's such a teacher. She's going around and helping people. Like, are you okay?
Tell me what the heck?
What is the answer?
All right, so you get the gist of it. I'm seeing a lot of algebra in some situations here. Others, I do have some parents that are drawing some of the pictures. I asked a couple of fourth graders to do this problem.
Oh, gosh.
I'm going to feel bad if I'm not right, because I think
I am. So these are two students that I asked to solve this problem. They both entered the problem very differently. So with this strategy that we teach, the ultimate goal is for the students to pick their own strategy that works for them.
They're smart.
And what we want them to do is pick the strategy that works for this particular story. So there's, you know, some kids might choose a model, one showed like the parts of a fraction, the fourth, and three-fourths is going to be four-fourths, and building off of that. So the beauty of it is that kids are allowed to be creative, they don't have to live in the, you know, lockstep way. And at the end of the day, like, them picking the strategy for that task is what we want them to do. They may choose a different strategy for a different situation, and that's the, like, the heavy lift of the thinking, is that the next problem that I give them is not going to look like this. So they'll say to me, I don't know how to do this one. You never taught me how to do this problem. And we're not showing them how to do the exact problem. So they're, an assessment won't be this problem. It will be how do you use the tools that we provided you for a new situation. Here's a brief snapshot of some number bonds on how they're introduced. And we're going to stop the math for now. But we're on to math. I know we have another problem for you in a few minutes.
But math is so fun.
Save some of that brain power for a few minutes. I just wanted to show you some of the ways that number bonds are introduced and how helpful they are. They're really just about exploring a part-whole relationship in a hands-on way. So this example, Sam put four cubes into two parts. Those two parts might not look like 3 and 1. Some kids might do 4 and 0. Some kids might do 2 and 2. And so we're like looking for all the different ways, and really what way do they see 4? And it depends when we start doing more complex strategies, what the other number they're adding to it is how they see 4. So that they can see 4 in many different ways, 4, 5, or 10, when the numbers become more powerful strategies for them. And so they always start with like the actual cubes and sorting them, and they'll start showing, maybe even in colors, like 3 of 1 color, 1 of another color, 2 of 1 color, 2 of another color, so that these visuals and the hands-on experience for them is like what's sticking in their brain, so that eventually they start seeing it that way. So in the number bond on the bottom, where it's just the numbers, that's a symbol for them, but they have meaning to it in the younger grades. They can start picturing. Can you see what 3 cubes look like and what 1 more would be? And then you can see 4. That's the very basic in kindergarten, how they start building on it. Okay. So really just a visual way to represent a concrete way for a part-whole relationship. I'm going to show you a part of a video from Dr. Von Haar. He came here last year to do a parent presentation. He's like the guru of Singapore Math, Math Focus. He's going to explain a little bit about how we transition from either cubes or counters or bears or whatever it may be to a number bond and then to a 10-3. That's a lot of primary needs.
My name is Sanha, and today I'll be talking to you about something children learn in mathematics. It is number books. What's number books? Young children learn by counting real objects, and afterwards they represent the objects using counters, so they may have six counters, and they learn to put the counters into two groups, four in here and two in here. So they learn that six is four and two. Four and two makes six. And they go through this series of actions. And six, how else could I break the six up into two groups? Could be one and five. So six is one and five. One and five. That makes six. One and five makes six. And they continue to explore. And after a while, they begin to realize that six can also be three and three. Six is three and three. Three and three makes six. So after a while, they begin to represent what they are doing using symbols. So they begin to write six is 5 and 1. 5 and 1 makes six. So other than the use of containers and counters, children can also learn about number bonds using counters on 10 frame. So this is a 10 frame, a frame that holds 10 counters, and children will begin to figure out that 10 is also 1 and 9. 1 and 9 make 10. So where do you look at when you say 1? Where do you look at when you say 9? And they begin to figure out that there are other possible combinations of numbers that make 10. And by exploring, or through the guidance of an adult, they begin to
So that's in the early grades through number bonds and the 10 frame is how they're doing all of their math. Okay. And then even later when they start building with base 10 blocks, when we ask them to arrange the ones, if they're building like 132, we ask them to imagine it on a 10 frame so that maybe two is easy, but if they have like six and they put them all in a line, they have to recount six every time to see if it's 136. But if they set it up in a 10 frame, they don't have to count anymore. They can look at it and know that it's six. So just some different techniques that help them like visualize the stuff in their mind when the numbers get larger, and we can't build 1,845, but we can picture it because of all the work that we've done in the younger grades. This is just an example of the 10 frames when it moves past the concrete phase where they're playing with it or building it on paper, and then they start to draw it. So when we ask kids, like, this is a common question that I've seen some of my friends asking, like, why can't they just know what 9 plus 6 is and count on and just know it by heart? Just not the best way, because then they're not flexible. The only way they see 9 and 6 is 9 and 6 more, and they have to count one by one. Or they end up just memorizing it that it's 9 and 6. But here we start asking them, like, how else do you see these numbers? So some of the strategies that they work on in the first grade with addition are making 10. So they're looking to see, like, that 9 and 6, how can I make 10 from that to use? We teach a variety of strategies, but at the end, they can choose to do it however they want. So some kids will count one by one, all of those 9, and then all of the 6 going on. Some kids will make a 10 frame physically. They move the pieces to see that they're 10. Some will count starting at 9 and count up to 6. And some will just know, and they can do this kind of work in their mind. So we're honoring, like, all those different ways that a kid can figure out 9 plus 6. But they don't have to just memorize it. The memory will come because of all their experiences that they've had with the stuff. Okay, we're gonna try another problem, and then I have a story to share after. We're only gonna take like a minute, so if you could just flip your paper over and try it on the same one. And then I'm gonna show you some of the ways that we teach it to how to solve it. So, after spending 1/4 of his allowance on a boat and 1/3 of the remainder on stationery, John has $18 left. Find the cost of the boat. You can talk to some people next to you. You can solve it. You don't have to solve it. Whatever you're comfortable with.
A helper. Like, Terry should be teaching, can work with all of our kids. No?
I'm gonna show you how to do it.
That's funny.
Yeah.
Oh, handing your work with the helper. That's hilarious. Do you tutor parents? We may need that. Yeah. That would be... I'll send my mom.
All right, I'm gonna stop. I know you might not have finished, but that's okay. Another really important point I wanna make is that, like, we are very focused on the answer, and in the classroom, we are, you know, moving into, like, also valuing the process that they went through. So what are the steps that you could take? What information do you know? How did you start the problem? And then kind of where did you get stuck? And that's okay, but we're trying to teach kids like how to articulate where they got stuck.
What grade level is this question?
This is like a fifth, sixth grade question.
Okay.
But I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you the way that we would teach this. I could hand this out in fifth grade and they would be comfortable doing this. Okay.
Wow.
So here's where a VAR model, which is the next part of my presentation, is going to be really helpful. A VAR model is just a way to represent a certain amount. So in this case, we don't know what his allowance is. So I'm going to represent the allowance. And I do have to say, Mr. Crawford solved the problem with this method. So,
do you have a fifth grader?
So here's the amount of the allowance. This is our unknown, or as some of you labeled it, X. And then we know that after spending a fourth of his allowance was on his book. So the first piece of the information that I'm going to chart out is that I put four parts, try to make them equal, and one of them is going to be the rest of the information I can get from the story is that one third of the remainder, so not this piece, but the leftover is going to be for the stationery. And it's convenient because this is like a fourth, fifth grade problem that there are only three parts left. So one of the parts is going to be stationery. And then I have $18 left for John. So we teach that these are represented as a unit or a card. So we would say that two units is equal to 18. So one unit is equal to 9. And then we can figure out the total allowance. So then they would write something like four units. And this is how students can enter some complex algebraic thinking that we might have solved this in a very kid-friendly, visualizing approach where they're using their knowledge of fractions of 1 out of 4, 1 out of 3, friendly numbers with 18 divided into two parts, like information and math that's very accessible to them. And then, so last night, I sent it to my brother, who's a doctor, he's a recent pediatrician, and I sent him a screenshot of the problem. And I told him I was working on a PTA presentation, and here, you can go solve this. Like, he's a, you know, obviously, like, he's super smart, like, you know. So I always send him this kind of stuff, saying, let me see what you do And then he gets obsessive with this kind of stuff. So he sends me a response right away. And this was his response. And so I started FaceTiming him going, sorry, no, this your answer is not correct. And then I FaceTimed him and showed him this. And he's like, well, I forgot, I didn't see the word remainder. So it was just so interesting, like, what kind of math kids can do in when we teach them how to visualize it and how to think about the things that they do know and work off the things they don't know rather than jumping to formal equations. And even if I gave this problem, the kids would have solved it in a different way. Their model would have looked similar, but some of their math would be very different. So here's a VAR model on how it's introduced in second grade. Again, it always starts with connecting cubes so that they can see how these 15 cubes are just going to now be represented with a certain bar. Like in the problem I did, we didn't know what the value of the bar is. It's just a visual representation for an amount. So it's a really helpful strategy when the numbers get into, four-digit number and another four-digit number or a division, subtraction, multiplication. We do bar models for any of the operations, fractions included. So it leads to some algebraic thinking. We're not teaching a formal, approach with X and Y and all the stuff that you saw my brother doing that, like, no, that's not right. But it's really helpful in allowing kids to see it in a variety of different ways and The power of it is that a lot of these problems, some students don't know how to enter through the complex math, but they can enter it in a bar model. So then when they get to middle school and they're doing this very complicated math, they have meaning to attach to it.
So is a good first question, if a child is stuck in math, how would you make a bar model?
I would just say, can you draw a model?
Can you draw a model? Right.
And start to put in the information of what you do know. So like, we knew a fourth of it was for the book. We knew that, you know, you have certain pieces of information that you can start to put in a model. In the upper grades, I would say, yes, it would be a bar model. But I would just say, can you draw a picture of your thinking and start with that so that I'm not telling them the strategy, they have to use a bar model. I want them to use the bar model when they're not sure what else to do next. Some kids, when they get very fluent with like this kind of in-depth problem solving, will jump into equations, and that's fine too. What we do ask kids to do that can do the equations is to do both, because the best way to show that they really deeply understand something is that they can do it in maybe three or four different ways. So the kid that's always jumping to equations, I'm going to make them do models. The kid that's really in the models right now, they're not ready for equations if they haven't mastered the model yet.
Good question. And when you say models, do you also like pie charts or whatever?
However they see it.
However they see it.
So I don't want them to see it how I see it. I want them to put on the paper what they see, so then I can teach into that. Because that's the only way I can get in their mind to see, like, how are they viewing this problem? What do they know? Like, are they missing the word remainder? I won't know unless they either talk it through with me or draw it. This is one of an upper grade bar model on fractions, what it may look like. Again, there are both, probably value both sides of this. There's a formal equation with all the number sentences, and then the bar model on the top. What I like most about this strategy is, in this particular problem, is that when I learned simple fractions, I learned like, well, whatever you do to the numerators, you do to the denominators. And I learned all these like cutesy little things, and here the kids will learn why. So at the beginning of this model, they would just draw a bar that has three parts. So Elena ate one third of a grapefruit. There would only be three parts. And then as they get more information, oh, we ate one ninth. Oh, well, I have thirds. How can I now show ninths? Oh, if I take a third and I cut it in three parts, three times, you know, three and three and three will give me nine. So then they learn, like, oh, that kid is thinking in that thought bubble. Oh, a third is equal to three nines. And they learn this through drawing and building it, even with paper. We would build models with paper first. These are just some ideas for summer. I'm always talking about U-cubed. I can't say enough about U-cubed and the tasks that she puts out there as a professor from Stanford University, Jo Wohler. And I will take anything off her site. I'm going to show you a couple of things. I've shown you this in the past. We have a handout of this for you with some websites on it. So I'll just show you where to find some of these things.
Do you have, does our school have credentials to get in? There's some one site.
It's all free.
Oh, yeah.
So you would go to Tasks and More, and then under Tasks, and in this tab here, you can sort it for grade levels. And the kids, I've shown this to them as well, so they're familiar with it. You can sort it under Concepts, Math Practice Standards, Topics, and they come up with some great activities that are open-ended, creative. They don't always give you answers, so that drives some of the kids a little crazy. But it's about the math and the thinking in it, and not about the answer in a lot of these tasks. The other great thing that she has on here is under Apps and Games. There are lots of apps in there that she recommends. Some of them are free, some of them you have to pay for. But all of them are well-researched and go with the same idea of, and really any of the math, all the research is saying that kids need to build stuff, draw stuff, play with stuff, and then move progressively to symbols. So all of this, anything she recommends, follows that same philosophy.
Is this an all grades?
Yeah,
the website is all grades.
All grades. So as you open up these apps, like this Olive one I did yesterday, and they have like a 3 to 5, a 6 to 8, a 9 to 12, and a lot of them are free on that Olive one. But there are other apps that she recommends that, you know, are like $5 and stuff, but it's better, I feel like, than going on to the app store and typing in like grade 4 math, and then you don't really know what it is. She also does have a free online student course. I have not taken it. I've taken her teacher course. But I would say from reading it and looking at the articles with it, it would be for like an upper grade student or for you to do with a younger grade student together. It's really about like seeing patterns in math, like what kind of attitude you have towards math, and math in nature, just different ways to think about it. But it's like 6 sessions, I think, and it's broken up into videos. So if you have a younger grade student, I would just sit with them if they're really interested in math. It just opens up the way they see the world. And then, as always, some of the other ideas that we're sharing about real life math, like the cooking, building, shopping, planning a trip, you know, all the things that you use math for in your real life to, you know, bring your kids into that. And there's one more website. I have this on handout, but can't see it on the bottom. It's a Greg Tang website. They have great games on there too, even for fact fluency. But I have the handout that you can take.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
As we sort of kick this off, we talk about like the new math, right? And by contrast, sometimes the conversation becomes like, when is it back to the sort of basic, right? Is the other like side of that coin. Now, you know, what I say is like, can you really get more basic than what Mrs. Alpha was talking about, right? That we first rely on like the pictures, the like hands up, but that really is back to basics. The new math isn't like new, it's actually more basic than the way that we were taught, which was honestly just like, repeat what I've done, don't think. So we're gonna shift to talk about
Keith,
literacy.
We have a question.
Oh, yes.
Question just because I might have to leave before. But in past years on the website, there has been a summer workbook. And I haven't seen it. It was here. It's definitely on there when my kid was in fourth, he's in ninth now, so I don't know at what point it maybe was done away with, but is that something that we should revisit and maybe bring back?
We're not going to have a workbook per se. I think some of the materials and resources that Mrs. Alpha talked about today, we're going to distribute it in an email that comes from me, a blast.
It was a universal across the school, across all schools, you know, this is what your grade, you should have mastered in your grade, and then it's a refresher of what was done at that level. I might have a copy of it.
Yeah, we're not going down that path. Instead, as Mrs. Oppel is sort of talking about, it's about these types of resources, the type of thinking underneath, not a sort of list of questions we're expecting students to do over the summer.
This
kind of
year is like what we're doing in the classroom, right? We don't give kids like 5 pages of sheets to do. Like, we're asking them to do maybe 1 or 2 complex problems, but they're talking to each other. They're disagreeing, they're agreeing, they're sharing their thinking. So it's about that conversation and the thought process that they're not necessarily a more, you know, 5, 10 years ago or a more of a
package. I think during the summertime it's just hard for us to know, you know, where their benchmark was, what, you know, they don't have that interaction with a peer. They have an interaction with us. So, you know, obviously we're having difficulty figuring out these answers. We're probably not their best peer. I'm just saying, you know, it's helpful just knowing what the benchmark expectation was when they finished second grade or third grade or, you know, just, you know, we don't know what necessarily. I don't know. I just had the feeling that I don't know where they should be at.
My advice would be to have have them go on the grade level that they are either ending or going into and try out some of the entities on YouTube.
And you feel that's on par with what your expectations?
Yeah, these are all based on the same Common Core standards, so we're using the same, you know, thinking and philosophy and expectations as she has.
Thanks.
Now we'll shift gears into literacy. But I always am so blown away listening to Projecta, like how much they do in math and the flexible thinking, and that really is such a goal in reading and writing. We want kids to do, to think in the way and interpret it in, a text in the way that they interpret it rather than just listening to how the teacher would approach it or the notes that a teacher would take. So that's why you'll notice, I'm sure, in a lot of the literacy work that we do that we're always throwing different strategies out at students or ways to represent their thinking. We want it to represent their thinking and not ours. So this is an activity that I did in grad school, which feels like a million years ago, but it still sticks with me because as the literacy coach here, I oftentimes will say to teachers, put yourself in the kids' shoes in order, like the best teachers really approach reading or writing the way, and they go through the process the way in which the kids are. So I want us to do that for one. I want you to think about a time when you read something that was too easy. So think about your typical beach read, or which, trust me, that's a lot of the reading that I will be doing this summer. Just think about, like, what are some of the strategies that you were using? How did that feel? What was, like, going through your brain? What were some of the things that you were doing as you're reading when it was too easy? Right, so just reflect on that for a minute. So I know for me, a lot of times I'm doing visualization. I'm not stopping often. I'm going quite quickly just because I do get into the text, but going pretty quickly. Anybody want to share what's happening with them when they're reading something that's a little on the easier side for them?
So I just have an easier time writing the book.
Okay.
Because if it's not complex enough, I just don't really want to review.
Absolutely. No, that makes sense. And I remember a lot of book clubs that I've been in the past. At first, I wanted to read the easier books, but then choose books that were out of my genre, the typical genre, and that it does challenge your brain when you go more for those like adult just write texts. Now let's think about a book that's too hard, or a text that's too hard. So this may be something like a medical article, or I know many of us have probably had to do research in the past that just seems a little bit different than your typical reading. So what were you doing a lot of the time? What were strategies that you quitting again?
Yep. Well, I like the
schools. She has more intense.
Sometimes I have to think of traffic characters if I don't feel in her name.
And how did it feel?
Fresh.
Also, yes. Repeat what they're saying so that we can hear it, because we can't hear it. Repeat what they're saying.
Okay. So she's saying, I was saying,
sometimes a little frustrating because you have to keep going back and rereading things that you might have already
read.
Because you might have missed some important point or character.
Right, so a lot of rereading, very slow, laborious.
I'm not a fan of reading on technology devices, but on the flip side of that, I absolutely adore the ability to click on define. And last night I had to read an article and was hitting define constantly, and it's engaging.
So stopping at that new vocabulary, or even like breaking down those really long words. I know once I was researching something about a medical, something medically, and it was very hard to even, like, I was doing a lot of decoding as an adult. So now let's think about just write books. Maybe this is a book that you have for a genre that you really enjoy, or a book club book. How does that feel? What strategies are you using primarily? About a book that, like, where it felt.
I think depending on the genre here, I mean, the newspaper article, if it's just right, I'm doing my skimming. Mm-hmm. So, but with a book club book that's just right, you're reading it, you don't really have to pause too much. So,
guys know that I love that you're taking it in. I was going to say, with it too easy, sometimes I find myself when I'm reading to my children, I am making mental lists of other things.
So maybe you're going too fast, or your mind isn't fully there. You're not as engaged as you typically would be with just reading a book. And I completely agree with genre really matters too. Whether you're reading something that's nonfiction or fiction, that makes quite a difference too. So we wanted to spend a little bit of time on Just Write Books, because whether your child is in kindergarten or fifth grade, they're talking about Just Write books or text levels. And a kid, child that was in a primary grade may say, like, well, I'm in H now, or you may start hearing your second, third, or fourth grader or fifth grader talking about like a text band. So I just wanted to give you a little bit of information about why we do find levels to be so important in these text bands and students reading at an appropriate level or band. I'll also define the difference between a text level and a band. But just give you, again, like a clear definition and then the purpose behind it, and show you a couple different examples. But I do want to preface this by, that's my first statement up there, that by no means am I saying that Just Write Books are the only books that your child should be reading. Particularly in summer, reading is going to look unstructured. Now, a lot of the times we have students read Just Write Books because we want them practicing the strategy that their teacher is inviting them to try out. And they can do that when the text is appropriate, whereas summer looks different. Like, we want kids getting just lost in their books and just being able to go to the library or the bookstore and choose what they want to read. They're exposed to so many different genres throughout the school year, so before they leave us, we will take time to have them reflect on what really spoke to them or what they want to do more of in the summer, and we'll send them off with those thoughts as well. I know for me even, I will be reading those books that are too easy because I don't read them a lot during the school year. I probably won't be doing the two hard books, so it'll be a mix of the too easy and the just right for me personally as well. But this is definitely something I want to make very clear.
Yeah.
So
when we talk about the Just Write Books, I know a lot of parents I talk to experience this. The kids come home and they have this book and they're like, Mom, this is a baby book. I'm totally not engaged. I don't like this book. I don't want to read this book. And to me, it's sort of like when we started, when we were talking about the book, how did you feel when things were too easy? Those are a lot of the feelings. And so a lot of times it seems like, although they don't necessarily test at a certain level, just because you can't necessarily articulate, that's a completely different skill set of what the child is taking in. So I wondered how you navigate that, because I know a lot of us have that question because our kids are not having at the particularly at the beginning of the year, and I know that's tough.
Right.
But you know, that comes up a lot, and my child was particularly sort of kind of downtrodden about reading at the beginning of the year, was reading less because of this sort of issue.
Okay, so the question is about Just Write Books, and if your child is disengaged because the book that maybe the level that their teacher is saying they're reading at isn't necessarily the level, like they feel like they can read more. So that's definitely something to reach out to the teacher about. What we try very hard to do, though, is to monitor that we're teaching kids to detect different text levels, but then we're always on the lookout for kids that are ready for that next level. But again, if this is a concern, and I'm sure it's not a problem with the teacher to just shoot a quick email, like,
hey, but if we did that, I did that.
Okay.
And the response was, you know, I know you think that this is sort of the level, but this is just right, well, this is where she's testing, this is, you know, what she, which is fine, I understand that, but I do think it becomes kind of an issue when the child sort of tends to go, like, check out for reading, or feel like they can't take their library books to school because, it's common.
Okay.
And so it's just something I feel like it's definitely come up with other people.
Okay. So let me just, a couple of questions, or a couple of pieces to that. So there are definitely different points during the school year, during the school day. During reading workshop, that's when the Just Write Book, where we're really leaning into the Just Write Books. But there are different points throughout the day whether it's choice reading, the extension block, where students are able to read books that maybe aren't attached to that specific level. I know in second grade it's still pretty much a level. So that's a time when they can read those library books. That's definitely not a message that we're sending throughout the school. And then homework as well, especially if parents are supporting the reading that maybe isn't, we just sometimes we'll see students that are reading like fifth grade level text in second grade, and they're reading it alone at home. But if you're reading aloud with your child and talking about the comprehension, I will talk about a couple different like nuances of these levels though, because there is a lot more that goes into the different level than just reading the words correctly and being able to retell it. And that's where the teacher wants to make sure that before sending a child onto the next level or the next text band, that that child is able to do the deep thinking that is going on.
Jen, I can speak to that too. And my experience is at home, my daughter reads at a one-on-one and it's a quiet room. Like, she's so on top of it. And I went to the teacher and like learned that there's a lot more in the testing that goes on to it, so that it's not just, wow, she can get through this book. There's a lot more. So it's making sure that we're complementing that. So at school, it's a different reading style and than it is just reading through the books at home. But it's definitely finding engagement.
This was an age thing, developmental thing. Because they have the ability to read the words, but the comprehension piece, they can speak through this book. My teacher says, I remember Mrs. Zankowski was slow down. And my child battled it. But after a year of slowing down, her comprehension so much better.
I can speak to you, Stephen, personally. I find that like end of first grade through the end of sort of second is where this is the most frequent discussion. And I think it's Louise you're speaking to it a bit. Because they've learned to word call, they've learned to decode. They can read Amelia Bedelia. Read Amelia Bedelia in all of the puns in figurative language and then ask your child about them. Like often they're not grasping those fully. And I personally understand that sort of dynamic. And what I find is it's very, you know, what's fortunate is at that level, mostly second grade, there's a lot of series books. Some series books are perfect for, you know, one series is perfect for one child, is not necessarily the perfect for another child. So I find that sometimes it's getting them, keeping them within that sort of just right, you know, area, but it's finding the sort of silver bullet book or silver bullet series that just brings them through.
And I'm happy to sit down with any parents too and just kind of give you, I would never give you like all of the nuances just because that's, I think, overwhelming for anyone. Even for teachers, like when we talk about text levels, because there's so much that goes into it. But I can talk to you about some of the different ways that the things that you can be pointing out or like stopping your child with. I've had several meetings with the teacher and the parent just to go through.
Like knowing what is it that when they're reading, it's not exactly what they need to be, like having a happy, even if you don't necessarily go over that symbol with them, it's just really comforting as a parent.
I have a niece who's in first grade. She's reading it at M right now, which I know is like a second grade level. So I'm in my head like flipping out, like, what is this teacher doing? Like lifting her level so much because I know what goes into every single level. That when I read with her, she can read every word beautifully. Her fluency sounds great, but she's not doing the thinking. She's not stopping to do that thinking and growing ideas about the character and just thinking about like what the problem is and the journey that the character is going through in order to solve it. So
you're going to step through some of that.
Some of it, yes. Okay, so I just want you to take a look at the handout. We'll quickly go through the first three pages. These are levels A, B, and C. So just take a quick look through here and notice like what are some of the differences that you see to notice. The first one is at level A, the second is level B, the third one is level C. Alright, so you'll notice on the first level A, this is like when our students just start reading. You'll notice it's one line of print. What we're looking for students to do is just the one-to-one corresponding, like can they touch and read? Does their sound, what they're saying, match like the amount of words that are on the page? There is no, we're not looking for like beginning sounds or anything like that. You'll notice a very clear pattern, and then the one word that changes is heavily supported by the picture, so the child will be able to figure out that word based on the picture. Then if you move into level B, which is on page 2, again, you've got a very clear pattern, and it's heavily supported with a picture. So this is, these are two separate like spreads. And then I put a copy, or two pages at the very end, because you'll notice that the pattern finally changes at the end. So that's, again, a level B book is just, it's a slight shift, but it's for a kindergartner, that's a big shift where they've got to start thinking about like what makes sense and then also matching that one-to-one. But they will like, start to expect that pattern change. And then if you look at the third page with the hungry squirrel, that's a level C. This is quite a jump from level A. You'll notice that there's a couple lines of print. And this is where students have to really start. This is still kindergarten and early reading, but they have to start thinking about beginning sound and even bringing some middle sound in. And this is where you're going to hear very helpful hints are like, does it sound right? Does it look right? Does it make sense? If you can say those three things to your primary child, whether they're in kindergarten or second grade, it's beneficial. So does it sound right? Does it look right? Does it make sense? If they can answer those three, there's a good chance that they have the word written correctly, or they read it correctly. And then we start talking about the retell. So in primary grades, it's a lot of like, so what just happened? Tell me about the book, tell me as much as you can remember. Whereas intermediate, we want them more thinking more inferentially on top of that, because that literal thinking should be pretty sure of. So then moving on to the next, if you look on pages 4 and 6, I have a blank copy of two different levels as well. These are more intermediate. So the first one is a level, what we call a text band. Now, A through J are really levels where there are different, like slight changes throughout. Once students are like in second grade, that's when we start talking about the band. So J, K, L, M is a band that's often read by our second graders. And there are very clear things that are going on in these levels. So if you look to this left side, I was going to give us a little bit of time to read through this, but I'll just go quickly. In JKLM, you've got one clear central problem. Okay, so that in all of these books, that's what's happening. Now, obviously, there's a difference between J books and M books, but we do give students like more flexibility in the books, and the teachers are guiding them through their choice. So they may say, all right, why don't you pick three J's, three K's, and maybe one L, like just as a challenge. The characters are very one-sided in these texts. Your student is going to start having to use those like 2 to 3 syllable words, really using decoding strategies. They're going to come across uncommon vocabulary, but they'll be able to figure it out based on, because a lot of times it's domain specific, which means you may have like it may be a book about soccer, so they may start throwing out like some soccer terms but it's within that realm. And then they also, within these books, they have to start carrying the story throughout the book, because up until J, there may be some chapters where the child just has to hang on to one story at a time, and then it starts shifting where the story, like the chapters, build on one another. So that's what's happening in our second grade, like typically our second grade books. And teachers are teaching they're teaching kids how to navigate this and how to notice the different tips on like where to go, how to read these different books. And then if you look at the next text that's in there is Stray. If I give you a blank copy and then one that I noted a little bit, you'll notice that these are more of our like fourth grade books, and these are much more complex. So I'll give you a minute just to take a peek at that. But the differences are that their texts that they're reading, so Mercy Watson is like an example of the books that we just talked about. So JKLM, so that's, this is like one problem. The characters are pretty one-sided, but their feelings may change. But as a second grader, that's a lot to navigate on this left-hand side. Whereas then we get into fourth grade. This is read as a third grade read aloud. But again, a read aloud is different in that the teacher is heavily scaffolding, really supporting the readers through this. So they're doing a lot of talking, a lot of guided practice. But typically this would be a fourth grade level book, like beginning of the band and at a level R. So the difference is that you've got multiple problems going on and readers have to keep track of the multiple problems. Characters are gray, so they're not the one-sided. There are like different dimensions to them. They've got some internal conflicts, how they act on the inside, it may be different from the outside, and readers have to think about, well, why are they doing that? And that's where, like, it seems like your child may be able to read through a lot of these books, but there's so much more going on. So as just a teacher, when I see like a second grader walking around with like a fifth grade level text, like, yes, they may be able to read it, but they're missing a lot of what's going on. And then I just fear that they won't want to pick that book up again when they're learning all the nuances that are going on.
And to experience that, I know we don't have time, but I think Stray is a great example. I must have read Stray, I don't know, 4, 5, 6 times, and 3 or 4 of those times in a group of adults. And several times as we read that, there were new points like made across years. Like we were reading Stray as an example for a few years. And so if you spend time personally with Stray, or even like because of Winn-Dixie, I would invite you as an adult to like really try to think through like all of the issues that are raised in that book and how, what a rich experience that is like for you personally. And it's not to say that for those fun reasons, a student can't, who can access the decoding, because of Winn-Dixie, can't read. They're, you know, if that's like lighting their day, there's something to sort of say to that. But I would also ask you, sort of like, what are they so blind to that's in there that we really wish they would go for? Like the deep sort of understanding that you're having personally with it. And so, as Allison's saying, like that's where the instruction is targeted. The classroom those levels to bring all of that out.
And particularly at RST, so I'm always blown away at like the books that are in that the fourth graders are reading. Like they're doing historical fiction. So I can't say enough about this setting acts as a character, or in one of the texts that we recently read in professional development, the setting is a force. So the setting, and you'll notice in Stray, as I read it probably for my 100th time, but I was noticing how much the setting is coming up. It's so influential to the story, and that's why, like, you know, students earlier, like, they'll pick up on, oh, the setting is the time and the place, but the setting is so much more when you, and it really plays such a role in the story. And also, students are picking up content knowledge. So again, with the historical fiction, like, kids are learning about, like, very definitive times in our history that changed the world. So they're not only reading a story, but they're reading along, like, very important information about their world. And really, kids have to start thinking, like, oh, that's a tricky chapter. The author did that on purpose. So it's not just like, oh, I'm confused. They have to, like, we teach them to notice when they're confused, and then, but to be okay with that and think, like, okay, let me read on and see if I can clear up my confusion. So there really is so much. And then the TUV, I would have blown your mind with some of the things that were going on in the TUV band, because there's a lot of symbolism, and that's what our fifth graders are reading. But again, our teachers are teaching it, whether it's the mini lesson or their small group instruction and conferring. They're teaching your child like how to approach these books and strategies to be successful with them. Okay, so this is where we get to this point at the school year where we want to share with you. So I'm just presenting it in a different way. These are a lot of the strategies that I've shared in the past. But your child is doing so much during the school year, but it really mirrors a lot of the things that you could be doing at home. And not that you need to be doing a lot of them at home, because summer is time to take a deep breath. And these are all listed out. I do have a handout. The list looks like this, but it's the exact information that is up here. But just a couple of things. So your child is, they are reading daily. So one thing that you can do is make sure that, like, most of the days of the summer, there is a time carved out where they continue to do that reading. That is really the best thing you can do for your child, is just to help them to read. But then on top of that, like, you also take part in the reading time. So I love hearing that families are, you know, whether it's during the day or they wait till both parents are home at night, just carving out a time where everybody just sits and does some reading. And I think it's good for kids to have like a structured schedule. So maybe they read it in the morning. Obviously there will be some changes because summer, you know, there's a lot of unstructured time as well. But if you can carve that out and make it a point from the beginning, it really will do a lot. And for like parents to model their reading life, I know a lot of us do like that digital reading. So on our phone or on our iPad, I find like one of the best tips that I had was that, like, to make it clear that, like, to your children that you're not just, like, reading or watching YouTube or, like, watching something on TV, like, you're actually doing some reading. And that's how you do your reading. And they may do it as they get older as well. Or they may be reading on a Kindle right now. Another tip is just to choose, they choose a reading spot that works for them in school. What works for you at home? Or maybe it's like it will add more excitement to like shape, figure out a different spot every single day. So the big thing is just like to make reading like a point, but also in writing as well, but make it fun and it can look different from school. But these are just some of the things that we do throughout the school year that can be continued. And I think if you start it from the beginning of the summer, then there will be a lot of impact. One of the things our kids do are they jot or they write about their reading. We don't want to pull them away from their reading too much, but we encourage kids to just know what it is that they're thinking. So you'll notice in the top left, like those are just symbols. Our kindergartners are just, they take post-its and they write a symbol that makes sense for them, or they write like one word to share the thinking that they were doing on that page that they can then share with a sibling or a parent. So whether they're in kindergarten, or you'll notice like some students like to stop, pause at the end of a chapter and write out in a paragraph like what it is that they're thinking. Whereas others, the one in the middle, this child is like capturing their thinking throughout the book and then they're laying it out on a page to like to watch their thinking evolve across the book. Your kids know how to do all of this stuff, and we do keep it very flexible and we want them to do what works for them. But ask them, like, what is the way in which you like to capture your thinking, or how do you like to jot about, or maybe they will say they don't like to jot, which many of them do. But it's just a way, we value it because it's a way for them to keep track of their thinking and then to watch how their thinking has changed across the text. Just a couple other things. Children can listen to you read. They listen to their teacher read. They talk about books together, so that can be part of your reading time throughout the day. There are different games that they're always involved in, activities and games, any kind of word building games, and I have some suggestions right now on the handout. Something I also love to hear that kids are doing are starting book clubs, whether it's within their neighborhood or just kids do it during the school year, but maybe there's a series that they didn't get to or like a recommendation from a peer. So rather than just, you know, getting together for a play date, maybe they could read at the play date or before the play date. And some kids do, some people maybe open their eyes at me, but some kids really, they do it and they love doing it. So just a way to get kids together, like thinking about the things that they've done throughout the school year. And then visit the Ridgefield Library. It's one of the greatest libraries I've ever entered. So you're really fortunate to have it in the community. So visit the library, get the kids accustomed to making that a regular routine if you can, or bookstores as well.
Parent-child book club is also sort of a great way to get your child with other parents getting together once in a while.
Yeah, absolutely. Or you can be a book club. Like you can call it a book club if you're both reading the book separately, or you're jotting your thoughts and they get together to talk about it. You can make it quite engaging.
Do you guys do book lists where you say like whatever level and you have like great recommendations?
Yes, so we don't get book lists ourselves, but we do have the kids, every teacher spends some time having the kids share their favorite books, and then they will come home with a list with our school logo, and it's just recommendations from peers. If there's a level that you're looking for, you can always look, like I always use Goodreads, I think is the one that I'll type, or I even type in like level N books, and then you can come up with like so many different lists. And then sit with your child and ask them, like, what are the books that you've heard? Because we always have been talking to partners in book clubs. They're familiar with a lot of the texts, so see if they can choose some of the books themselves.
Alice, before you transition to writing, I just want to make one point that we haven't really touched out there. Clear. There are some students who have trouble decoding, right? They have some type of exceptionality going on that is interfering with their ability to decode. We are really sensitive to those types of like select circumstances, and often it's in conversation with parents about making sure their comprehension is growing, right? Because there's sometimes you can hear parents will get under the impression that we'll become too focused on the decoding, piece of a Just Write book, and then that possibly is, you might hear, like inhibiting this growth in the other area. We engage in very specific conversations about, you know, an individual child and with parents about that circumstance. So there are some students who we say, you know, that's a really great point. We need their comprehension to keep going, and we do that in a variety of ways across the day anyway, but we need their comprehension to keep growing. It's perfectly fine if your child is not as accurate or as fast as we want them to be. So you're definitely attuned to that and engaged in those conversations.
And that's where like books on tape are great, or that read aloud time at the end of, you know, the end of the night or first thing in the morning. Like, you can have, like, the students can still like listen to the book or maybe take turns reading, or just a way for, because they can do that thinking. Like some of our students who struggle with decoding, you put them in a read aloud set, it's amazing, like the thinking, so they should be doing that as well. So that's where like books that are too hard for them technically to read, that's a great book to pick up and read together or take turns with. All right, so then just a couple things there. This is all on your handout, so I won't go through every single one, but ask your child what kind of writing they'd like to do. I mean, there's so many different versions. They can write a song, write a poem, a neighborhood newsletter, write to a favorite author, but it doesn't have to be like, okay, you sit down and write for 15 minutes, like you do it, you know, or they write for much longer in school, but just a way to do some kind of writing. Another thing is, I have up here too, they can write a book review, and they can even put it on a blog. So Scholastic has a great one that's called Share What You Are Reading, and students can read a book and then write their thoughts, and others can read it. Spaghetti Book Club is another one for that. And then Mr. Margolis actually shared, our journal buddy, one, that an idea that his wife brought home of like they writing back and forth, like taking a journal and writing back to your child. And it doesn't have to be like a daily thing. I hope you don't mind that I shared that.
I just didn't know where you were going.
He was sharing that his wife goes back and forth with one of his daughters, and it's not a daily thing, but they can communicate, like just via writing. So even if you get like a new journal, I know I have a 3-year-old at home who has taken one of my old journals or notebooks, and she like carries it around now all the time. She scribbles in it, but she just engages. So anything that will like cause that excitement.
Mine carries around number bonds and marbles.
I bet he didn't even know that.
He might throw them at
me. And these are just a couple of the ways that we've always supported kids. We have Kids Start Yet. We have plenty of time in June this year. So we will be talking about setting goals for summer. And that may look like I'm going to read this genre because I really liked it and we didn't do too much of it this year. Or it may be I'm going to read 4 days a week and I'm going to, last year I offered a calendar to kids, and some of them even returned it to me showing like they put a sticker or a check or something. Just anything that motivates your child to, but the goals can look any, you know, they can, we really keep it very open-ended because we want them to buy into it and then want to do this. We have our, like I said, they share peer recommendations. Our librarians are gonna come in and talk about their resources that they've done every year. We will be collecting the Governor's Reading Challenge, so like a tally sheet, so if your child wants to, like, I encourage them to keep track of the books that they're reading, and then we celebrate that when they come back. And then we'll also do the BES Summer Reading Picks, where you just take a picture of your child reading, send it in, and then in the lobby, we post the pictures. The kids love coming back from summer and seeing where everybody, I love seeing all the pictures. It can be like their special spot in the house. It could be on a hammock. It could be away, you know, at the summer house or something. So we love seeing them all. Are any questions on any? Right, just one. This is a quick 3-minute video that we've seen in the past. Just a reminder of the growth mindset. This is so beneficial for kids. Just to. We're constantly working on it at school, but I think this is a helpful video just to see like how you as a parent can shift your mindset and the way in which like the feedback that you give your child really does make a difference.
When parents spend time thinking about their own mindset, can recognize aspects of both growth mindset and fixed mindset in their own thinking. Sometimes we might have a fixed mindset about some abilities like math or art, but a growth mindset about others. If we want our children to develop a growth mindset, we need to be mindful of our own thinking and of the messages we send with our words and with our actions. Here are some examples of fixed mindset statements and corresponding growth mindset statements. Think about what messages they send and what messages you want to send with your own words.
Praise kids for being smart. But this kind of praise sends the wrong message. If our kids are praised for being smart when they understand something quickly, then what will they think when they encounter something hard? Being praised for intelligence can make kids think, if my past success made me smart, my current struggle makes me dumb. Instead of praising your kids for being smart when they understand something quickly, praise them when they work hard to accomplish something difficult. This tells them that you value hard work, and that hard work is what leads to success. Kids learn how to behave by imitating others. One of the most powerful ways that parents can model a growth mindset is by being willing to fail and eager to learn from setbacks. When parents talk positively about the mistakes they make, or the mistakes their kids make, their kids start to think of mistakes as a natural part of the learning process. That's critical for having confidence to take risks and invest themselves in challenging work. It's also critical for having the self-assurance to calmly reflect on one's own mistakes, instead of just trying to sweep them under the rug or blame someone else.
At first, it can be difficult to develop a growth mindset, but it's worth it because research shows that parents can have a powerful impact on their kids' mindsets. Remember that developing